I think most of you know that Diet Preppies has been here at least since the 1960s, when it was introduced from Puerto Rico. I was thinking this morning that there was this is the same time frame when another group of Beatles from Liverpool were introduced into the United States, so for what that's worth. The adults of the Diet Preppies, you hear they're mating, and they're going to lay eggs, and they're going to lay those eggs in the canopy. They're going to feed on the canopy, and when the eggs hatch, the neonate young larvae are going to fall to the soil, and they're going to develop in the soil. And this process happens during all of the warm months. It's not just one cycle during the year, but it's many cycles going on and overlapping. With these kinds of problems in the cortex of the root system make entries for Phytophthora, which makes this a pest disease complex and makes it all the worse. And then to top it off, of course, as Lucas was talking about, HLB has complicated all of the other diseases and pests on citrus and made them worse as well. So what about management? What's been recommended over the years? Well, we talk about, first of all, planting the right rootstock, because it's a pest disease complex, and the more resistance you can get to the Phytophthora out there, the better off you are. So depending on the species of Phytophthora that you anticipate, there are different rootstocks that are recommended. For example, Swingle or C35 if you're dealing with P. nicotiani, and Cleopatra mandarin, some of the pumelos and mandarins if you're dealing with Phytophthora palmivora would be recommended. And there's good evidence from previous work done by McCoy and other people here that it makes a big difference if you get the right rootstock in there. Improving the drainage is important, because Diet Preppies populations really do increase in situations where the soil is wetter. So if you have a situation where you can improve the drainage, you should do that if you're battling Diet Preppies. You should do it anyway, because your trees will appreciate it. And then finally, as far as managing directly the insect, the idea is to monitor, as Lucas was talking about just now, monitor the Diet Preppies populations, because they peak a couple of times a year as they emerge out of the soil. So you can take advantage of those peak periods to go ahead and time your applications of adulticides and ovicides to try and reduce the amount of larvae that are falling into the soil. And then as far as dealing with the larvae, there are really no pesticides other than nematodes that can be put into the soil to reduce the population of the larvae in the soil. There's also the possibility of putting a chemical barrier on the soil. It works moderately well, but those chemical barriers don't last for very long, and they're quite expensive as well. So. There's really no silver bullet to managing Diet Preppies, and even with the best management, the weevil can continue to be a real major problem year after year. And that has just gotten worse since HLB arrived in Florida. So, as I mentioned, they have multiple generations, and they're falling into the soil and coming out of the soil, except at this time of year, except in the wintertime. And so that idea that they have life stages in different areas really, really complicates management. Essentially, this is showing that as the eggs hatch, they're developing here and eventually emerging. Woo! This thing works all kinds of things, doesn't it? They're developing, and eventually the adults are emerging from the soil. And so we talk about what I just mentioned, monitoring and spraying or using nematodes. But the problem is all of these tactics that we can recommend are non-persistent. All right, and so as they wear off, as the adulticide wears off in the canopy, more adults are emerging. And as the nematodes die off after a month, 6 weeks, more larvae are falling into the soil. So they're constantly being replaced, and that's what makes this insect so difficult to manage. So what about the chemical the chemical control situation. Well, Lucas pointed out very well all of the problems that we all know about as far as overusing. These things are expensive, and you end up with resistance and knocking out your beneficials, and a lot of reasons that we don't want to rely just on rotating insecticides to control the problem. There are new chemistries, a lot of them that have come into being since work on this, on when greening came into the state, work on diapreppes pretty much ceased. And since that time, there have been a lot of new nematicides, or new insecticides, excuse me. And those are being studied at the moment. CRDF is supporting a project to study those with reference to diapreppes. So there will be some more information on new products coming along here within the next few years. And then the other possibility I wanted to talk about today is the use of physical barriers here, keeping the adults from emerging out of the soil with these landscape fabrics. And then in the situation with the larvae that are in the soil, it's the same situation, except that, yeah, the nematodes are safe to use, but they're very expensive to use, so we can only really afford to put them out a couple of times a year at the most. Maybe we could modify how much area we're treating there and get some beneficial results, maybe reduce the cost that way, increase. Talk about that in just a sec. And then what about the possibility of a physical barrier here too as well? All right, so we keep the larvae from getting into the soil. What's possible in those terms? So what research do we need right now going forward to improve the situation? We need better detection. And there are attractants that have been discovered, very effective attractants. They're quite expensive, but as the cost comes down on those, hopefully they can be deployed to monitor the insects for the spray programs. And we need much more research on these new insecticides, the possibility of using physical barriers, and the possibility of modifying how we use entomopathogenic nematodes. So what about monitoring as it stands right now? The best thing that anybody can do is as you're resetting trees in your grove or replanting, pull some of them. Don't just clip them, but when you do pull them, rinse them off and look at them. Because very often if you've got a diapreppes problem, you won't know it until your grove starts to decline. But if you're pulling the trees, you will know it instantly. So that's something that's very important to do in this day and age, is to look at your roots as you reset your trees. Above ground, symptoms are typical. We've got a lot of material in the back during the break that you can look at if you're not familiar with it. I think most of you are, but you can be monitoring for signs of leaf damage before you see the weevils. Sometimes you'll see that as well. And then you can be trapping as well. We use these ground traps, these cone-shaped ground traps, primarily in research to catch the adults coming out of the soil. They're rather, difficult to use. But a tetter's trap is quite easy. The problem, and what's happening is the adults are emerging or they're just moving around in the grove and they mistake this for a tree trunk and they get trapped. So growers can use these. Maybe a dozen or so of them in a block will help to determine if you're getting a peak emergence period. But they're quite inefficient. And it's, in my opinion, it's just about as efficient to go through and just be tapping the trees, looking for the weevils above ground. But they can be used for that purpose. We use them in research, but we put out hundreds of them, and they provide the kind of information that's needed for some of those experiments. So what about the fabric soil barriers as far as keeping the insect out of the soil or keeping it from coming back up into the tree? They've been studied for a long time, and initially they were found to prevent the neonates from passing through them into soil by about 97%. So it's a huge reduction that can be gotten just from the insects going into the soil. When they were put out in a grove situation, again, quite some time ago, it was shown that they absolutely are effective in keeping adults from coming up out of the soil. The difference in it went with traps that were placed here or here in a bare soil, it was a difference of a huge difference in the amount of traps that we were In fact, we only caught, I believe it was one insect in this experiment coming up near the tree trunk, whereas we were catching several hundred in the uncontrolled. So they were very effective at keeping the adults in the soil. When we put the traps right on the edge to see whether the adults could be crawling out and coming out through the edges, we didn't get any significant differences here. So they're not really escaping along the edges effectively. And so from that standpoint, they look quite effective. One of the problems, though, that we notice as these are being deployed now, some people are beginning to put these out in Florida, is one thing you want to be very careful about is making sure to keep them clean. In Texas, they're using these as well for diaprepes management, and they bed up on a slope, and they make sure that these are applied sloping in two directions so that soil doesn't accumulate on them. If we were doing it on a flat situation, we'd have to develop, appropriate methods to make sure they stay clean. In a lot of situations, they do, but in other ones, they don't. And when they don't, the weeds will grow through this, and they will provide opportunities for the weevils to get in as well. So that's going to be one of the problems that have to be dealt with if you decide to deploy these things. But the real research right now that's needed is we know that some of these neonates are going to get through. And when they do, how much damage are they causing? If we're going to spend $1,000 to lay tarp per acre, in the end, is that going to pay for itself in terms of reducing the damage that's occurring by the weevils, that the larvae that do get through? And so that's just research that needs to be done. Here is a tree in the situation where we have the tarps down. They were put down on an infested field, so there were clearly insects there to begin with. But on a few of the trees that declined, we pulled them up, and already you can see some really major damage that caused those trees to decline. So the real question is if they're employed properly, are they going to reduce the damage enough to pay for themselves? And that research remains to be done. What about IPCs? What about the protective covers here? We know that the weevils can't be laying eggs, and so it's going to protect those trees really well for as long as those covers are on the trees. And there are some experiments in the state right now that are showing really good differences in how well the plants are growing. And the question right now is going to be whether or not, as the covers come off, the covers have finally come off those trees, how well are they going to persist? How well is this effect going to persist? One final thing that what we're looking at in terms of this is we're looking at treating both kinds of trees right now for the larval larval problems that they have now that the weevils are laying eggs on these trees as well as on these trees. And we're putting out entomopathogenic nematodes on a monthly basis during the warm months right now. But we're only putting those nematodes. Let me just show you something real quick, digress here. One of the things that we've noticed in this block where trees were either covered or not covered is after Hurricane Ian, about 20% of the trees are tilted at at least a 45-degree angle on those trees that weren't covered, that just didn't have much of a root system, compared to the trees that were covered, where maybe about 1% of them are tilted. So you get that additional advantage. But where we are talking about maybe the possibility of improving the use of nematodes is right in here, in this part of the crown area of the tree. It's a very small area compared to the rest of the root system. And the same number of insects out here on the periphery roots are not going to be causing the kind of damage that those nematodes are causing right here. So the question is, if we stopped treating out on the edges and started simply treating around the tree trunk, we could increase, for the same cost, or for less cost, we could increase the applications to every month, no problem. And the only question is does it work? And again, that's ongoing, and we'll just see.